The next item of business is consideration of business motion 5127 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to today's business. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And moved.
No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 5127 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions. In order to get in as many members as possible, I'd appreciate short and succinct questions and responses. And at question number one, I call Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how avian flu is affecting bird populations.
Cabinet Secretary Marie Goujon.
Winter of 2021 and 22 has seen the UK's largest outbreak of avian flu, with commercial and backyard captive flocks and wild birds affected. And as of the 21st of June, 10 captive bird premises in Scotland have been infected with highly pathogenic avian influenza H5N1. And in the same period, the virus has been detected in 1,253 dead wild birds across Great Britain, with 467 findings in Scotland in 24 different bird species. While the impact of the outbreak on wild bird populations is currently unknown, there have been reports of significant mortalities in Scottish seabird colonies.
Ariane Burgess.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer. Gannet and Great Skua populations in Shetland are being decimated as we speak. Gannet colonies are strewn with dead birds, and fishers are seeing carcasses floating at sea. They are all washing up around Shetland's coastline. What actions can the Scottish Government take to limit the threat to internationally important breeding grounds in Shetland and elsewhere?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, firstly, I would just want to assure the member and members across the chamber that the Scottish Government is taking this situation very seriously. And of course, we're working with a range of different partner organisations to monitor and respond to the situation where action can be taken. Avian influenza is a highly infectious disease, with the current strain is causing significant mortality in seabird colonies right across the UK. And even though there is little that can be done to limit the spread within the colonies themselves, yesterday Nature Scot announced that it was going to suspend all ringing activities within seabird colonies for the remainder of the breeding season, essentially to try and reduce the risk of onward transmission from infected colonies to uninfected colonies in other locations, and to really also try and minimise the additional stress on potentially infected birds. The Scottish Government as well has also published advice for local authorities, for landowners, for wildlife rescue centres, as well as members of the public, regarding how to report, also with information about the collection and safe disposal of dead wild birds. And we will keep that guidance under continuous review as the situation continues to develop.
Ariane Burgess.
Thank you for that response. I'd like a little bit more detail. Seabirds across Scotland are now being affected by avian flu, and I'm particularly concerned by the news that it's reached the world's largest gannet colony on the Bass Rock. The RSPB is calling for better monitoring of the virus and greater clarity about how dead seabirds are being collected and disposed of to avoid further spread. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide clarity on those points?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, well, Nature Scot are monitoring the numbers of dead wild birds that are reported by the reserve manager, and they're carrying out, where it's possible for them to do that, surveys of the affected colonies too. But as it stands at the moment, it just isn't possible for us to assess with any certainty the extent of some of the population level impacts. But we are working in collaboration with Nature Scot, with the JNCC, with the RSPB and VTO Scotland as well, to look to try and collate that colony level demographic data and identify how that data can be analysed to offer information on population level impacts. But I would also just want to take this opportunity to emphasise that the current advice that we're giving is that wild bird carcasses should be left in situ unless landowners consider it necessary to remove them. And as I've just said in one of my previous responses too, we have published updated guidance about the safe removal and disposal of carcasses when that's required, because the disease is spread mostly through live birds rather than through dead birds.
Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I know the Cabinet Secretary is aware, there are seabird populations of international significance within my region of the Highlands and Islands. So can I ask where we are with implementing the Scottish Seabird Conservation Strategy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, the Scottish Seabird Conservation Strategy is currently undergoing amendments, essentially to try and ensure that the actions that are derived from it are timely and they're going to be effective to help optimise the conservation prospects of seabirds in Scotland from both existing and from emerging threats too. And that includes the disease threats such as avian influenza. And we're aiming to consult on that in the autumn of this year. But I would also want to point out that even though the strategy hasn't been implemented yet, it wouldn't be restricting the Scottish Government from responding to this issue, as well as making plans for any future instances of HPAI.
Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The images from the Bass Rock in East Lothian, home to the largest colony of northern gannets in the world, are truly shocking. The Scottish Seabird Centre in North Berwick says it feels powerless watching avian flu spread across the colony. East Lothian countryside rangers have the heart-wrenching job of cleaning up dead birds washing up on our popular coastline, and I would like to pay tribute to the rangers. So can the Minister confirm whether any additional government resources are going to be made available to the East Lothian countryside rangers and other similar services and agencies in other parts of Scotland hit by avian flu? And will the Minister now redouble her efforts and support the call from the Scottish Seabird Centre for an acceleration of the National Seabird Conservation Strategy, because the need has never been greater?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I welcome that question from the member, and he rightly points out just how horrendous some of these images are. And again, I know that the rangers have the unenviable task of trying to dispose of some of these carcasses, which I know will be a horrendous task in itself. I hope my previous response to Emma Roddick answers the latter point that the member makes about the conservation strategy and where we are with that. And as I say, we are consulting on that. But even though that hasn't been implemented, it doesn't prevent us from taking action and dealing with some of the threats that we currently face as well. So I would really just want to give him that assurance, and also emphasise the points that I've made today about the importance of gathering that data. We do take this threat particularly seriously, and that is why we're also working with all of our partners to do what we can to try and tackle some of the issues that we're seeing arise from this.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that the avian flu outbreak has been particularly devastating for overwintering geese, killing an estimated third of the world population of Svalbard barnacle geese in the Solway. And sadly, more and more of my constituents are now commonly finding dead birds strewn along paths on the shore. Now, given the devastation, does the Cabinet Secretary accept there's a need for more action to build resilience in the long term with measures such as looking again at, for example, restrictions on sand eel fisheries and properly ending bycatch so that we can build resilience and better conserve our seabirds?
Cabinet Secretary.
I recognise that all of these points are really important, and both myself and the Minister for the Environment, Mary McCallan, had a meeting with some of the organisations last month to discuss what other action we can look to take. So again, I would just want to emphasise that we do take this very seriously. That's why the partnership working and the collaboration that we have with other organisations is so critical, because we want to do everything that's it's within our power to do to try and tackle some of these issues. So of course, I give close consideration to the points that the members raised.
Question number two, Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reported warnings from a leading scientist that its opposition to gene-edited crop goes against the scientific consensus.
Minister Mary McCallan.
Presiding Officer, we are committed to maintaining the highest environmental standards in Scotland, and we remain opposed to the use of GM in farming, and that to protect the clean, green brand of Scotland's £15 billion food and drink industry. The use of genetic technologies is a complex and emotive area. Indeed, the UK Government's own public consultation last year saw the public reject the changes that they are now pursuing. So while I am closely following scientific and other considerations on the decoupling of genetic modification and editing, Our position hasn't changed, and the UK's bill doesn't change that.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank the Minister for that answer, but she continues to miss the point. Yet again, she deliberately conflates the two issues of gene editing and GMOs, and that is disingenuous and only weakens their untenable position on this. Presiding Officer, the Minister would seemingly prefer to wait for the EU to tell them what to do, but surely when their own former chief scientific adviser says that they're out of kilter with scientific evidence, does the Minister not agree that she should have a serious rethink on the SNP's position and stop holding our farmers back?
Minister.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. First and foremost, I'm more than happy to confirm to the member that I am absolutely up to date on the issues, and I am not deliberately conflating GM and gene editing, although I'd remind her that she is in a parliament in a country in which gene editing is still part of the definition of genetic modification. I absolutely welcome and actually hold in the highest regard the views of our scientific community, including Professor Dame Glover, and our academic institutions, and indeed our food and farming and food producers. What I also value are the views of the public. This is an emotive and complex area, and matters have to be considered very closely. And in fact, in that regard, I agree with Professor Dame Glover when she said on the 9 yesterday evening, as a scientist, I think it's a very interesting technology, but I do think at the end of the day, it's up to politicians to decide, using all the evidence available. Some of that will be scientific evidence, some of it's economic, some of it will be ethical, and some of it philosophical. Those are exactly the issues that I am considering, unlike the UK government, who are hurriedly pursuing this post-Brexit deregulation.
Rachel Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, farmers in my constituency are extremely worried that if this SNP Green government doesn't give their backing to gene editing, then they will be at a major disadvantage compared with their neighbours just south of the border. And that concern is shared with the NFUS, it is shared by the James Hutton Institute, it is shared by the Roslin Institute. Gene editing technology would give our farmers a much needed boost to help drive down food prices, help our food security issues right now, and support climate change goals. I think the Minister needs to look at what her priorities are here. Are they constitutional obsessions and grievances? Will she listen to the experts and work with the UK for positive change?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, conversely, I think it's the Member's constitutional obsession and her and her colleagues' desire for unity at all costs which is the problem here. And I wonder if she has read the joint statement which was issued by 30 groups on the 10th of June, including the RSPCA, Friends of the Earth Scotland, sorry, Friends of the Earth generally, not just Scotland, Soil Association and Compassion in World Farming, among others, who've said this bill represents a significant change in the law and has huge implications for farming, food, animal welfare, the environment, the UK's internal market and its trading relationships with key global markets. It's clear that in haste to deregulate, the government has not adequately considered these implications. And I do hope that Rachel Hamilton and her colleagues will consider that joint statement. But equally, she talks about the threat to Scotland's farmers. The real threat to Scotland's farmers, of course, is an ideological Brexit, the hardest of possible Brexits, pursued during the second wave of a deadly virus, and of course made worse by trade agreements which undermine standards in welfare and the environment and undermine farmers' livelihoods. Where was Rachel Hamilton's concern for farmers when her colleagues were negotiating that?
Jim Fairley.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Setting aside the science of this matter for just a moment, on a practical level, the fact is, you don't want to hear it. I know you don't want to hear it, but just listen. The fact is, on a practical level, the fact is that Scotland was invited to participate in this legislation the day before the bill was introduced at Westminster. Requests for a site of the draft of the bill were ignored until the afternoon before it was introduced. Now, this is disrespect verging on thinly veiled contempt from a Tory government that is encroaching into devolved competences within the remit of this Parliament. So does the Cabinet, does Minister share my view that the Tories in London want Scotland to consider its legislative proposals, they must learn to treat our Parliament and this Government with some respect?
Minister, briefly, we are very quickly running out of time.
That's fine, Presiding Officer. Thank you. Yeah, Jim Fairley is absolutely right. There is substance here and there is process, and both are important factors. I've expressed my disappointment with the timing of the UK Government's letter regarding the bill, with the invitation for Scotland to join the legislation coming the day before it was introduced to the UK Parliament, and they were briefing the media at the same time as doing that. Discussions of this nature should have taken place prior to the introduction of the bill to enable the consideration of any divergence. And if the UK Government was genuine about its commitment to devolution, it would be serious in its cooperation with Scotland and with the other devolved administrations.
Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome what the Minister said about being led by evidence, and I think it's wrong to set aside the science, as Jim Fairley just suggested. We should be looking very carefully at what this science offers us as potential benefit. And NFUS Scotland believe, this is a statement of theirs, that GE offers the potential for Scottish farmers to meet the challenges such as climate change, plant and animal health, and market competitiveness. When will the Minister next meet NFUS, and will she engage in a conversation, a positive conversation with them and indeed the UK Government about the potential benefits that will be accrued to Scotland because of this science?
Minister.
I will meet NFUS when I attend the Royal Highland Show this week, and I have no doubt that this issue will come up, and I look forward to discussing it with them.